Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
Almighty God, Eternal Father, to whom is ascribed all honor and glory. Forgiving God, we confess we have sinned against you and each other. Forgive us, Lord, and help us to overcome our sins. Help us to be more loving and kind to each other, and enable us to love as you have loved us. We pray for world peace. Dear Father, let there be peace on earth, and let it begin within the church, among families, friends, and loved ones. Take away any hatred, jealousy, and envy from within us. We pray for the sick and shut-ins and the needy. Father Lord, continue to heal and provide for us as you promise never to leave us nor forsake us. We pray for the church and all those in authority that they will continue to be inspired, encouraged, and guided by God's Spirit. We give you thanks and praise, Lord, through your Son Jesus Christ, for accepting and answering our prayers. Amen.
A reading from Deuteronomy chapter 31, reading from verse 1 to verse 9. When Moses had finished speaking all these words to all Israel, he said to them, I am now 120 years old. I am no longer able to get about. And the Lord has told me, you shall not cross over this Jordan. The Lord your God himself will cross over before you. He will destroy these nations before you, and you shall dispossess them. Joshua also will cross over before you, as the Lord promised. The Lord will do to them as he did to Sihon and Og, the kings of the Amorites, and to their land when he destroyed them. The Lord will give them over to you, and you shall deal with them in full accord with the command that I have given to you. Be strong and bold. Have no fear or dread of them, because it is the Lord your God who goes with you. He will not fail you or forsake you. Then Moses summoned Joshua and said to him in the sight of all Israel, Be strong and bold, for you are the one who will go with this people into the land that the Lord has sworn to their ancestors to give them, and you will put them in possession of it. It is the Lord who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not fail you or forsake you. Do not fear or be dismayed. Then Moses wrote down this law and gave it to the priests, the sons of Levi, who carried the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, and to all the elders of Israel. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
My mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I will preface this message by saying that I'm not here today as someone who can quote many scriptures off the top of my head, or someone who has studied the Bible from cover to cover. I come to deliver a message, or rather share a simple word about a lesson which I learned, which I have had to relearn, and which I will most likely have to learn again in the future. As you are well aware, July is Missionary Month, and the message of a previous devotion broached the topic of the diversity of missions, essentially relaying that carrying out our mission is really figuring out the way or ways in which we can contribute to God's larger overall mission and execution of these roles. I come today to reflect on a specific aspect of the execution of our mission on this journey called life. When it comes to our journey and execution of our mission, brothers and sisters, a smooth ride is not promised. Our journey is about falling down and getting back up. About failing, but seeing it as redirection, not failure. About making mistakes, owning them, and seeing them simply as opportunities to learn, adjust, and grow. And about dealing with various pitfalls on our path. But the good news is that we don't have to do it alone. We can lean on God. And I think that a crucial element of achieving our mission or missions on this journey is that thing called surrender. And I truly believe that the sooner we are able to do just that, the smoother our ride will be. Now I'm sure that the phrase let go and let God is familiar to us all. We've all heard it. We may have heard it and given a resounding amen. Or in these times where virtual worship has become customary, we may have typed amen with several praying hand emojis to emphasize just how strongly we believe that this is indeed the right approach. We may even say, when someone shares their difficulties with you and reveals their current state of overwhelm, you might say, shall you just need to let go and let God? It's nice and catchy, and it really is great advice. But who is really doing it though? How exactly does one go about letting go and letting God? I'm not here to dispute whether it's a good suggestion. I'm not here about the why. I am more about the how. And hopefully I can shed a bit of light on that. If I can just take you back to the reading from Deuteronomy 31. And to give some context, here Moses is addressing the Israelites and reassuring them that all will be well as they look to cross over to the promised land. Not under his familiar leadership, but led by Joshua. Not Moses who led them for 40 years, but Joshua, who they could rightly view as a less experienced rookie. Home in first on verse 7, where Moses speaks to Joshua, who is facing what likely was a somewhat daunting appointment. Be strong and bold. And then in verse 8, it is the Lord who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not fail you or forsake you. Do not fear or be dismayed. And I'd like to just break down these two verses for a minute. Essentially, they're telling us that we can be strong and bold because one, God goes before us. He paves a way and finds a path. God will be with us. He accompanies us along the way through our various trials. He doesn't prepare a way and send you on your way until you get through. No, he is there with you all the way. Three, God will not fail us. Assurance that we can rely on him. Four, God will not forsake us. He got our back. And it goes on to say, do not fear. So don't be afraid. Don't panic. Don't fill your days with anxiety and worry. And do not be dismayed. So don't be discouraged, demoralized, distraught when things are tough or don't seem to be working out. In these times, and at all times really, we can lean on him. And if we tap back to verse 6, we see a call for the Israelites to show courage, to exercise their faith in God. For not only is Moses not going to be leading them to the promised land, he ain't even going. So you can imagine what an unexpected turn of events and adjustment this would have been for the Israelites, especially if their faith relied on and was tied to Moses and not to a firm reliance on God. Sometimes our faith, our confidence, the extent to which we trust that something will work out lies in the wrong place. Sometimes it lies in familiarity. Things are normal, I've been here and done this before, so it'll be good. Sometimes it lies in self. I know I can do X, I'm good at doing X, so when I'm called to do X, I'll be fine. Sometimes it lies in the knowledge or abilities of others, in family or friends, or people in positions of power, authority, or influence, or those with special training, doctor, parliamentary representative, minister, pastor. Well, Rev told me pray about it and it can work out, so I feel it will work out. And we may find ourselves unwittingly putting our faith not so much in God, but in them. We trust because someone can see a way forward. Someone can see a solution. Someone has a vision that we don't have. Someone can offer advice on that particular how-to that we can't visualize. Or someone is praying for us. And it's only when life lands us in a situation where we get cat's paddle and none of these people can help us figure it out, none of them can bring us the peace that we need, that we are awakened to the fact that our faith isn't really at the level we thought it was. We come to the jarring and what for me was surely a most unsettling realization that our faith was rooted in either what we felt we had under control or someone else had under control. This is where we are really called to let go and let God. This is where we are challenged to relinquish that innate desire for control, to know what can happen, how it can happen, how soon it can happen. This is when our faith is really tested. And for me, when I reached that juncture, it was as if the faith that I thought I had amassed over years of Sunday school, Sunday services at James Street Methodist Church, Alpha Course, Disciple One Bible study, and if I'm honest, far less than enough Bible reading done on my own. It was as if that faith, when I turned to it, said, "Who, me? Not me, Bo," and got up and left the room, because it was not firmly rooted in God. I would like to spend a little time looking at how we can let go and let God. If you examine the phrase, there are two components: let go, let God. Letting go. Let go of that urge to control, manipulate, orchestrate, figure out, and know everything. And I will use the current COVID situation as an example. My friends, I encourage you to view COVID as not only bringing hardship and anxiety, but also some blessings, opportunities to grow, and countless lessons. So I invite you to reflect with me. Have you approached this pandemic with an attitude of let go and let God? Are you praying fervently for deliverance from the pandemic? For protection from the virus? For providence during these times because things are real hard? For the curfew to end? For things to hurry up and go back to normal? Are you praying but still freaking out, as they would say? Still killing yourself to watch every single press briefing live? To scrutinize, analyze, and criticize the COVID dashboard statistics on a daily basis? To search Google and YouTube for info on COVID, on the vaccine? Infusing yourself in the anxiety of WhatsApp chat groups discussing COVID in every spare moment of your day? And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that you shouldn't keep abreast of COVID news or shouldn't try to be informed. Rather, it's the extent to which these occupy your time, the over-reliance on them for peace of mind, the loss of sleep and neglect of other affairs to engage in these activities, the compulsion to know everything, even aspects that you can't comprehend but somehow feel the need to know about. That, my friends, is more about control. That is grasping and grappling, not letting go. May I suggest praying for peace of mind through these times? Praying for buttressed faith. Praying for that which allows you to let go and for support as you let go. But I also think it is important to be clear about what letting go isn't. And by way of example, you might have lost your job, and it sure is very natural to worry about that. In this instance, letting go is about, despite these very understandable worries, trusting that you will find a new job, assuming that is God's will, and feeling confident that you will be okay in the interim. It doesn't mean pray about it, put out your feet, binge watch Netflix series day in, day out, and do nothing and feel it can happen just because you pray. Think of prayer as less like a noun and more like an active verb. You don't just pray, you pray and do. It is tied with an action, with an effort guided by what I like to term God's nudges. Some call it prompting by the Holy Spirit or being led by the Spirit. Now we come to letting God. Letting go and letting God should be intertwined. What is letting God? One, It is first acknowledging, then accepting and saying, God, I know I am not strong enough, smart enough, skilled enough. I am able to deal with my situation on my own, and I need your help. Then allow God to take over. In the words of another, give God room to wield his mighty arm in your life. And it's okay, very natural and very human to really struggle at times. And I like how someone put it, allow yourself to crumble for a few. Emphasis on for a few. If you feel helpless, realize that it just means that you need help, that you cannot manage on your own. 2, pray. And we tend to get caught up in fancy prayers, pretty language, big words, long prayers, but they don't have to be so. Just have to be real. Simple, God help me, that is a prayer. Have conversations with God, talk to God, share your doubts and fears with God, seek his guidance. 3, leave your ego and intellect at the door. Don't say, I'm letting go, and continue to ruminate on the problem with a steely determination to figure it out on your own. And I will admit that I really struggle with this one. 4, be quiet. Be still long enough so you can actually sense God's little nudges. We are so busy, too busy. And that constant busyness is not only physically draining, but it also makes it more difficult, if not impossible, to receive God's messages, to notice opportunities. Slow down. 5, look for opportunities. Keep an eye out for them. Be open to them as they present themselves. It isn't necessarily for you to find them. Believe that God will lead you to your next step, that he will bring the right people into your life at the right time. He will open doors. In our reading from Deuteronomy, we are reminded that God does his work through people. Bringing the Israelites to the promised land was God's work. It was God doing it through Joshua. So trust that God will put people in your life to lead you through. 6, and nobody want to hear this one. Be ready to step out of your comfort zone at times. That is often where the magic lies. Be ready to take a proverbial leap of faith. 7, try to keep focus on what is going well for you, even though it may seem buried beneath worries and obstacles. Be grateful. And 8, be patient. Don't say, okay, I'm letting go. Lord, I surrender. And follow it up with, all right, I surrendered, so what's next? I don't really see a way yet. And why should we let go and let God? Because God loves us. God is with us. God is always with us. Psalm 46 verse 1 says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. God is always with us as we traverse the challenging landscape that our life journey presents. He's there to help us navigate the deep and murky waters that we encounter, to guide us through the various challenges that confront us. Let God be your pilot. We often say a prayer called the Lord's Prayer. We all know it by heart, but do we really take it to heart? It says, give us this day our daily bread. Provide for my needs today. Not give me a glimpse or a clear view of what is coming down the road. Daily needs. And if I study it, thus far there hasn't been a day in my life that I did not already have or receive what I needed to get to another day. Stop and think about it for a second. Why then really should I doubt that this will no longer be the case? Why do I continue to be crippled by fears and insecurities, repeatedly feeling and acquiescing to an urge to figure out things when I can let go and let God? When I can trust in God's providence, trust in his timing, and be patient. Finding that delicate balance between letting go or relinquishing control and making a spirit-guided, reasonable, faith-bolstered effort is tricky. That's where we often struggle, where I for sure struggle. As much as I'm here today telling you that letting go and letting God is the way to go, as much as I firmly believe that, when it comes to execution, I am very much a work in progress. So I say this not as one who has mastered it, far from. Rather, I say it as one who has come to realize that whenever I can manage the surrender, whenever I do not feel or act on that innate desire for control, whenever I stop trying to manipulate life events that I really cannot control, and let me tell you, we do that in many little ways that we don't even recognize. Whenever I decide to stop worrying and fretting, I am fine. Most of you listening will not know about me and my current life situation, and I'm not really here to talk about that. But suffice it to say that the last 5 years of my life have brought me some of the lowest, most challenging, painful, heartbreaking, gut-wrenching, soul-searching, and lonely moments of my life. But in retrospect, that bleak landscape was always dotted with little sprinkles of light and hope, and likely my most transformative experiences. God always put a rainbow in my clouds. I have a background in academia, in science to be more precise, and several aspects of that training do not really align with this whole concept of letting go. I was taught to be inquisitive, to question things, to be analytical, to examine and try to figure out things, to scrutinize with objectivity and draw inferences based on the evidence before me. In other words, based on what I can see, read, or what is visible and tangible. I was strongly encouraged to use my brain or intellect and then realize how much, when that's applied to other areas or all areas of my life, that involves suppressing a key factor in letting go and letting God. So imagine how much of a challenge it is for me to unlearn that at my tender age and adopt a let go and let God approach. You see, I've learned that God is in control, that I need to acknowledge and accept that He's in control, that I need to let go and let God, and that when achieved, my friends, it comes with a level of peace and comfort and joy that you won't believe. It comes with a quiet confidence that you will somehow get through all of those difficult situations that seem unnavigable. Not with the promise that life will be a cakewalk. Not with the promise that you won't ever have to endure pain or suffering, or that there will not be challenges and seemingly insurmountable obstacles. But it comes with the conviction that in spite of all these things, you'll be okay. That where you see a closed door, there may be an opening. An opening that is not visible to you, and at times not even visible to the very go-to people who are usually there to help you figure out things. But trust that it is there. The door will often appear when you stop desperately trying to find it. When you surrender. The door can come in the form of assistance from someone who is a total stranger or someone who you may know but would never expect to be there for you or to be able to help you in that way. But trust me, if the door is to open for you, it will, and absolutely nothing can get in the way of that. I'm not saying that all of the doors that you want to open in your life are going to just fling right open, because sometimes we want and feel we need things that aren't for us. What I'm saying is that what is for you will be yours. So resist that urge to worry and that urge to control things. Don't go away from here saying, "That one, Sister Workman, is a liar. She tell me doors gonna open for me and they still ain't get that 50-inch high-def TV I wanted. Or I ain't get that job I applied for. Or I ain't get the position in the church that I was nominated for." Those, my friends, are your doors. We often make plans for our lives and even aspire towards missions for ourselves. And when they don't play out as we wish or when we wish, we feel a sense of disappointment or even failure. Friends, I sure didn't plan to be where I currently am in life. I didn't plan to be unemployed. I didn't plan to be stricken with a health challenge that nobody really fully understands. I didn't plan to be forced to live a restricted life, to be able to do many simple things that I once took for granted but am now inclined to view as privileges. I sure don't see this on the cards for me. But I can choose to fix my gaze on all of the doors that have been closed to me and try desperately to figure out my own way forward, as I have done for way too long now. Or I can opt to surrender, to say, God ain't got a clue how to handle all of this, but I know that you do. And with that simple prayer, I can opt to believe that even though my view of my future is very hazy at best, that I can rest assured that God got my back. You see, I strongly believe that my principal mission was tied to my job, that while carrying out my job, I was achieving my purpose, at least in part. So when I lost my job, I, with my narrow view and this misrooted faith, also lost my sense of purpose. Letting go and letting God, when I actually managed to get it done, allows me to trust that my mission here on earth has not abruptly ended, has not been aborted, truncated, or to use simple parlance, it didn't get messed up, but rather that it has diverted or transformed, or that I am on a different aspect of my mission or in a new mission. Brothers and sisters, I am not saying that it's easy to do. Many times I fail to let go and let God, over and over. But what I will say is that the smoothest parts of my current life journey come when I simply surrender. When you see me smiling and skinning my teeth, know that it is because at that moment, I am being carried by God. So I end by inviting you to join me as I strive to simply trust God, to let go, and to let God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I couldn't seem to fall asleep. There was so much on my mind, searching for that peace, but the peace I could not find. So then I kneeled down to pray, praying, help me please. Then he said, you don't have to cry, 'cause I'll supply all your needs.
As soon as I stopped worrying, how the story ends,
when I let go and let God have his way,
that's when things start happening, when I stopped looking at back then,
when I let go and let God have his way. There's so much going on, sometimes I can't find my way, and oftentimes I struggle from day to day. I had to realize that it's not my battle to fight. I have to know if I put it in your hands, everything will be alright.
As soon as I stop worrying, how the story ends,
I can let God have His way back. let go and let God. He's the only one with the answers. Just let God. He feels your pain, and He knows your heart. He knows your issues. He knows
You have all our future in your hands. I bid you take over all our lives, Lord. Our dreams, aspirations, all our best. Jesus, Lord, our hopes, our fears in your hands. Keep walking beside us every night, every day, and giving us courage for the fray, Lord. We need you to guide us every step of the way. Forsake us not, Lord, we pray. In your hands, Lord, we place today and tomorrow. In your hands, Lord, we surrender all. In your hands, we commit our joys and our sorrows. In your hands, Lord, we surrender all. Lord, we ask that you would teach us how to submit our lives to you. Show us how to abide in you day by day, and instruct us how to live in spirit and truth. Help us, Lord, to give control of our lives over to you in every way, and to become the people you would have us to be. Thank you, Lord, that you have not given up on us, and we ask that you teach us your way from this day forward, in Jesus' name. And now, brothers and sisters, may the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. And the people of God say, Amen.
We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to his word, and may it dwell in all of us richly.